Warning, adventure activities can be extremely dangerous. Please use extreme caution when out in the elements, and if you should, go ask your mom. Now, go ahead and in.
Awesome, but I don't know if we're ever going to be the kind of people or anyone else is going to find a stash of that kind of gold out in those mountains. But sadly, you can't really see. We're heading that way.
Yeah.
We'll be there in like 45 minutes, but...
You know, back in his time, though, the reason it kind of bothered me was because, you know, it's still 45 to an hour to get there from here, right?
By car.
By car, it's at 80, right?
Yep.
But back in the day with a mule, my God, it was going to take days, right?
But those old timers, they went everywhere, like, you know, doing the Indian ruin stuff or the Native American ruins and all that. I still am fascinated how far they got.
Well, they didn't have anywhere to be, right, in a sense, right?
Yeah, exactly. And I figured Jacob Waltz would be in that same boat because, I mean, traveling from Vulture Mine, Wickenburg area down to Phoenix, that's a journey in and of itself, too. So
absolutely.
Pretty cool. But, yes, what this does tell me is that Jacob Waltz is real. It tells me that, you know, even though he was German, the Lost Dutchman did exist and that he had gold. From that point on, I have no idea what the next little part of this story is going to bring.
James, I think that's a great way to start, right? I think we're off on the right foot. And so I'm excited. I'm excited to find out what else, you know, what other journeys bring us to this exciting. This is one of the most exciting tales in history. You know, I know people in European countries all over the world, James, and they know this tale like it's a tale from their country. So this is a big deal.
Well, in a world that doesn't have a whole lot of mystery left, this is fun only because it does draw so much interest. It draws intrigue because it is something that's unsolved in a period of life where we don't have a whole lot of unsolved things.
Well, you know, my buddy from Kansas City, Greg, who his family dug the riverboat, right? They all told him he was crazy. They all told him that, you know, you're not going to find anything. How could a paddle wheel boat be in the middle of a field, you know, 10, 15 miles from the river? Well, guess what they dug? They dug it and it was real. And it was one of the, you know, so.
They did it the same way. They just traced every piece of history that was known, correct?
Absolutely.
So that's why I'm on board with this, because this is how you do anything is, you know, you dissect piece by piece any type of unsolved thing and you go from there. So that is a good reminder that they did find the steamboat Arabia doing this. Everyone told them it was impossible.
Absolutely.
So let's keep trekking.
That's actually a pretty cool little... You know, James, probably the sign that we ought to take in stride is the one that says do not enter, because if you look right up there, that looks like the gateway to Superstition Mountains, right? So when you're on your journey with the Lost Dutchman, one place you probably want to stop into is the Superstition Mountain Museum, because this entire museum was put here to house all the collection of information that has to do with the full history of the Superstition Mountains and the Lost Dutchman gold. You know, we're at the museum today, and one of the things that's just fascinating is, look at the amount of cars that are here. Look at all these cars.
We're busy today.
That just goes to show you how many people are intrigued with the Lost Dutchman gold. So let's go on inside and see what's going on. Think. Jay Shrek, Myths, Legends, and Lies, and I'm at the Superstition Museum today, and I'm with Bill
Hayes.
Bill Hayes. Bill, tell me a little bit about this fascinating museum that you have here.
This is a fascinating museum. We got our start by a group of individuals that wanted to preserve the heritage of the area,
mm-hmm.
So they formed a society. They got their start at a little display case down at Apache Junction Library.
Right.
Then they were lucky enough to get a spot over in Goldfield, that's just about a quarter mile up the road. And then they were lucky enough to purchase this land.
You know, what's so fascinating about this story is you know, we have videos that go all over the world, and it doesn't matter where you're at. If you're in Spain or England or Australia, everybody knows the Lost Dutchman gold mine. Isn't that unbelievable?
Yes.
It's just a fascinating story, and the fact that you have a museum just based on people that loved the story. And tell me a little bit more about what you can see from this location right here. Think. So right now, when we're looking up on this hill, there is the Peralta stones, is that correct?
That's correct.
Now, what is the significance of this location right now, looking up there with those stones? What am I looking for when I'm looking up there, Bill?
You're looking for the, it's called the horse map.
Okay.
Okay, and the front of the horse map is a horse's head. And as you can see up here, on the very top, on the left top, you have about three quarters of the horse's head.
Okay.
Okay. At the back of the map, there is a tail that's halfway down, which indicates you got to go to the back of the stone.
Okay.
Okay. So if you go to the back of the stone, we have what's called, there was a priest who was holding a cross.
Okay.
And that's a directional thing. Now, the priest has, some people call it a wizard's hat, but it's a priest hat, and it's curved.
So that's the second one, mark,
yes.
On the far left-hand side. So the praying hands are the first one, is that correct?
That's correct.
And then the wizard's hat or the priest's hat,
yes.
And the horse's head will be on the very top point of that. And that's significant points in this horse map. Am I correct with that?
That's correct.
Okay.
Yes.
So this would be a great place to get started if we're looking for the Lost Dutchman, as far as I'm concerned.
The Dutchman and the Peralta families tie in very closely.
Okay.
Okay, depending on what legend that you want to hear, some of the legends talk about Jacob Waltz as actually befriended by the Peraltas.
Right.
And helped work the mine. So that's how come he knew where the mine was.
Okay.
Okay, so that's one legend. Another legend is that they were looking for the lost soldier's mine.
Okay.
Okay, and they were attacked by Apaches, and most of the group that was looking for the lost soldier's mine, they didn't want to do this game anymore because it wasn't worth their life.
Right.
Jacob was basically gold crazy. He chased gold from East Coast out to California,
right,
and
right,
back again.
Right.
And he was looking for it. He wasn't going to give up the search, so he kept the search going. Most of his provisions were gone because of the raid, and some Mexicans found him, took him up to, could it be the Peralta mines, could be another one, otherwise it was rich.
Right.
At this time, Arizona was in U.S. territories.
Okay.
And Jacob said, you aren't entitled to it because you're Mexican and I'm an American, so I'm entitled to it. And there was a mini massacre, and that was his goal.
So there's all kinds. There's the Peralta family, there's Jacob Waltz, there's even DiGrazio and his paintings,
yes.
and there's the Dragoon pistols, and I know Larry here found a treasure, it was from Cutty Sark, or he found actually a treasure that they actually hid there,
mm-hmm.
And was one of the few people that was able actually to find some type of riches out of here. So the museum, if people want to come here is open 7 days a week from what, 9 to 4?
9 to 4.
Is it open every day of the year?
It's closed Thanksgiving and Christmas.
But that's it?
That's it.
Oh, wow. So if you want to come out here and start your search, or if you just want to stay on the couch and follow us, this is a great place. We're going to kind of get together with the museum, and they're going to help us out on our journey also. So I can't wait. This is going to be a great experience. Bill, it's been a pleasure. I look forward to working with you guys. And you've been awesome today. Thank you.
It's been a pleasure for the museum and for me.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Let's go find some gold. Well, you've heard it here first, right? Well, I mean, not first, but come on. I mean, isn't the story just intriguing? And it's intriguing enough for me to go traipse out there 20, 30 miles a day, right, to see what's out there. And James, what do you think?
Well, I think the stories alone are compelling enough, and the legend has been, compelling enough for so many people to give their lives looking for it, that it's worth us investigating, if nothing else, just
to. But you're not bought in completely, are you? But you do realize today, I tell you what, so far today, you have to agree that it's a pretty compelling story.
Oh, 100%. And I definitely like that we're getting even more information, which leads me to believe, you know, there's a reason so many people have spent so much time and effort and resources out here, so.
I can't wait to find
I'm
the gold, James.
I'm excited to get out there. You know, I just want to hike anyway.
Yeah, you just want to hike, so. Yeah,
I'm excited.
Thank you, Bill. We appreciate you.
Thank you so much.
You've been awesome. Really it's praying hands right there to the. Is it up
the
there?
Spear.
Oh, so it's over here.
I'm pretty sure that's praying hands right there.
I thought maybe it was that over there.
Well, from this perspective, I'll have to look all this up too.
Well, it's still the same. Still the same story.
No, exactly. It's just as far as the. So I think maybe those are praying hands. That group of three, the closest to us. And then you got the hat and the horse. Are up there.
Well, I think we got a good point to it anyway. Right, and that is, I find this story so fascinating, and one of the problems with some of the maps and things like that is they have locations that you can see at certain areas and you can't at other areas. So there's places that you might see a rock formation that may be the praying hands, but if you're at the wrong area, the wrong angle, the sun's at the wrong place, guess what? You can't see it. And you know, this mine may be at a place where you can only see it at a certain time because the shadows in the desert are unbelievable. And if you've ever been out here and experienced that, you know that you might be able to see something here prevalent. But when sun goes to the left or the right, coming up or going down, you can't even see that location. So there's so much to this. James, what do you think?
I think I do know that what these do is they put direct placements of exact locations matching maps to real-time mountains. And then beyond that, like you said, it's all up to some kind of interpretation, because if in 1860, the sun was hitting these a certain way, someone saw a hat, or they saw a horse head, or they saw praying hands, and if I'm out here at, 2 in the afternoon, and I'm on the wrong side of the mountain trying to place a map, I could get it completely backwards.
You know, one thing that's fascinating that you say that is, have you seen the picture of the panther or the jaguar, right?
Exactly.
And it only comes, what, two times a year? And you can't see it all the rest of the time. So it completely shows you how the light changes. And so somebody could have been walking past all these areas and not have seen it before because they weren't there at the right time.
Exactly.
So timing is everything, isn't it, James?
It is very relevant.
It's getting time for us to go in the mountains, isn't it?
I think we should go take a little hike.
Let's do it. Oh. Okay, James, you know what this means.
What does this mean?
Another day, another adventure, another car wash.
Because we're in the car wash?
That's right.
It's true. And I think